Hello everybody, this is our video for class 8, and the subject of class 8 is DITA translations. These slides outline the concepts covered in the 8th session. Some of the slides may be repeats from earlier presentations. And this is obviously an online session. So the topics that we will cover today are translating DITA best practices, XLIF, translation memory and TMX, term base and TBX. The reading for today was the XLIF 2.0 book, chapters 1, 2, 3, and 4. Also the TM and TMX URLs listed here in the syllabus, and the term-based exchange URL listed in the syllabus. Next week, looking ahead, please come prepared with questions on whatever concepts or tools you may need help with. I will come to that class prepared to discuss the final deliverable. I will walk through the DITA XLIF deliverable with the students, with you, the students. And if you follow along with me, you will have completed that that requirement. We'll also talk about the user guide, the Easy DITA user guide, and anything that you want to discuss or anything you have questions on. And that will be our final gathering, our final meeting in person. So before we talk about translations, let's get some of these terms straight, because there's a lot of acronyms. And I will be using these throughout the course of the presentation today. So LSP stands for Localization Service Provider. That's a company providing translations and localization services. SRX, Segmentation Rules Exchange, and XML, Open Standard Defining How to Segment Text for Translation and Other Language-Related Processes. TBX, Term-Based Exchange, is an open standard for representing and exchanging terminological data. TM, translation memory, is a collection of segments which can be sentences, paragraphs, or text strings that have previously been translated in order to aid human translators. TMX, translation memory exchange, is an XML open standard defining the exchange of translation memory data between computer-aided translation and localization tools. XLIF, XML Localization Interchange File Format, is an XML open standard defining lossless interchange format for translating text. Let's start with XLIF. Translating can be easy or difficult, and that's because of the paradox. The paradox is that DITA's strength is its ability to harness many topics for a variety of outputs. DITA's difficulty for the localization service provider is that it has all of these many files. So let's just take a look at what we mean by that. Translation can be difficult. So we come along and we say, hey boss, let's switch to DITA and component content management. It's a great idea. And the boss kind of scratches his head and doesn't quite get it. And we say, but it's nimble, and the boss still isn't that interested. No more document-centric constraint, and the boss really kind of doesn't know what that is. It's supported by tools and best practices. By this time, the boss has been distracted and is probably no longer paying attention. And then we say, we have more precise information for our customers. And the boss says, show me the money. And then we say, we can save boatloads of money and time and money on translation. And the boss is all excited about that and says, let's sign up for that. But 9 months later, what often happens is we don't see the savings. In fact, sometimes it can go the other way, and the boss will be really confused by that and probably upset. The problem, the paradox, is that we have a lot of DITA files that can be tedious to process one by one. So if we look at the example that we've used several times in class, we see that we have a couple of maps there, a bunch of images, and a bunch of topics. And to process those one by one really takes a lot of energy. But think of DITA projects. That's a simple project. DITA projects can consist of hundreds, thousands, or millions of topics. A localization service provider can process these topics, but it's not their core competency, and they would rightfully charge extra for the overhead and the expertise. So let's consider this our kind of go-to data sheet. It's 36 pages, 32 DITA maps, 283 DITA topics, mostly reference, 46 images that are also available as SVG or PNG. To look at that on the file system, that's just a ton of files, and we're asking our localization service provider to process those one by one. No wonder they would charge us a lot of overhead for that. So let's walk through that ill-advised workflow without XLIF. So we have our DITA repository. We get those 350 files. We just put those together in one big blob, and we say, or one big group of files. We hand that whole bucket of files over to our localization service provider and say, please translate these. Notice in the upper left-hand corner, upper right-hand corner, we're in January, beginning of the year. So then we, the localization service provider does something. We're not clear on what they do. It's kind of a black box to us. And then at the end of the day, they kick out all of these translated individual topics, and they hand the bucket back to us. The problem is, we look at the calendar, and several months have gone by, and they've the translated files are at risk of being expensive, exorbitant time to translate, and poor quality. So this is kind of the ill-advised workflow that we just looked at there. So if we look at step one in the blue box, everything in the blue box is the content owner's domain, and everything in the yellow box is the localization service provider's domain. So steps one and two, we collect and gather all of the files, and then we provide them to the localization service provider. We just kind of throw them over the fence, throw them over the wall without much instruction. So then the localization service file provider has to test all of those files. They have to, step four, transform them into XLIF or open them as DITA files and figure out how to translate them. They leverage translation memory. The translation is done then in the computer-aided translation tool. Step eight, the XLIF is transformed back into its source format, in this case DITA. The translation is in context reviewed, all of those DITA files, and then they throw it back over the wall to us, and we have translated content, which we then import in step 11 there, back into our repository. So if you send 350 files, the localization service providers will charge you for file management fees for 350 files. They will open each file and test for corruption. Best case, they would have an automation in place to enable the topics to leverage TM, to be edited in their computer-aided translation tool to be reviewed and converted back to DITA. Worst case, they will leverage translation memory and translate each of these 350 files one by one. So let's just look at that, consider that in real time. So each of these little icons is actually meant to demonstrate one of those 350 files. Even if we were just to process them this quickly, you can see that by the time we open each file, test for corruption, even if we have automation in place to leverage translation memory and to edit in a computer-aided translation tool and to review, that's still going to cause a lot of overhead. Or, worst case, if we have to open every single one of these files, find a way to translate the DITA, because remember, DITA is not a native file format that the computer-aided translation tools can natively open. They can import them sometimes, but they can't natively open them. So if we're asking the translators to process each one of these 350 files one by one, no wonder they're going to charge us so much for the overhead and the processing. So I tried to keep talking all the way through this load, but that's a lot of files. So the risks are that it will be expensive, that it'll take a lot of time to do the processing, the quality may suffer, we may have inconsistent translations, the file conversions could misfire And because the vendor would develop this expensive way to this de facto standard to do this translation, we might be locked into that vendor. And of course, we can see that the boss will be unhappy, because all of those units of money are being thrown into that wastebasket there. So what is the best practice? Well, the best practice is to translate DITA via XLIF. How does that work? So the strategy is to take advantage of DITA's map files in order to manage the many topic files. So we would create an XSLT to read the map file and convert each of those referenced files into a single XLIF file. So we have our DITA repository, we have a DITA plugin, the 350 files are compiled into one XLIF file. We hand that single XLIF file to the localization service provider. The good news is it's the XLIF is the native computer-aided translation tool format. They can leverage their translation memory, and they're following best practices. So once they do that, they hand us back the translated XLIF file, and we have saved time, money, improved accuracy, and the boss is happy. So this is kind of how the workflow works if we use that kind of a model. Remember, everything in blue is the content owner's domain. Everything in yellow is the localization service provider's domain. So what we've done, I'm not going to go through all of these steps again, but what we've done is we've automated in the steps that make sense for the content owner to do, and we've minimized the steps the localization service provider will do, or even a better way of saying that, we are letting the localization service provider do what they're best at. Might as well pay them for what they're good at, and that's for doing the translation, not the overhead. So if we send our localization service providers one XLIF file, they will not charge file management fees for 350 files. They will open the XLIF file in their CAT tool. They will perform all the translation workflow steps, including leveraging TM, editing and translating in their tool, reviewing and converting back to DITA is not needed because the risks are mitigated. So we have lower expense, we've saved time, we've improved quality, we have consistent translations, no file conversions to misfire, and no vendor lock-in. So what about XLIF? What is this XLIF all about? XLIF is XML Localization Interchange File Format. It's an OASIS standard for exchanging localization translation content. Translation tools use XLIF as their native file format. Translators know and like XLIF. 1.2 was passed in February 20, 2008 with a schema and a specification. 2.0 was passed August 2014. The URL is there in the slide with a specification and a schema. And XLIF 2.1 was just passed this January 2018 with a schema and an XML specification. Why do we think this is a best practice? Well, the DITA Adoption Technical Committee actually said so, and there's a URL you can go where they have the article that tells why using XLIF to translate DITA projects are best practice. So the translation workflow looks something like this. We have source language XML files, in this case they're DITA, and also the source language images, in this case SVG. We transform those all into a single XLIF document. The localization service provider translates these files. The translated file, is then one single bilingual XLIF file, which we then import back into our repository, and we have a carbon copy of the source language file in the target language, and then all of these tens, hundreds, thousands, millions of files find their place back into the repository. So this is because XLIF supports the extract and merge paradigm. We have our source, we extract the localizable text and format information into a single XLIF file. The localization service provider opens that file in their CAT tool, translate the text, save it. We have the bilingual file, we convert it back into its original format, and we have a translated DITA project. The reason XLIF is so good is because it's just dirt simple. We isolate the translatable text into translation units, where we have here the source text and we expect the translation to go here. We retain the source's document structure either in an internal or external skeleton file or internally with group elements. So I mentioned that all you have to do is write an XSLT to read the map. You don't really even have to do that. I've done that for you, for the community, I should say. I've created the DITA XLIF round trip plugin for the DITA Open Toolkit. And I'm going to demonstrate that in a minute here. So I would encourage you to follow along. And these are the steps that I will go through. I will refer back to these steps when I do this demonstration. Again, I would encourage you to follow along. You will have a second opportunity to follow along in class next week when we're in person. So we're going to install the DITA Open Toolkit. We're going to download the DITA XLIF Round Trip plugin. That is in D2L under the resources directory in the content directory. So we will put the XLIF and the DITA from XLIF folders into the plugins folder in the Open Toolkit. We'll call up the command line, we'll change directories, we'll set our environment variables. Of course, you will set your environment variable based on your location of your files. It won't be necessarily the same as you see here in step 6. We'll test the environment variable. Once we're sure that it's correct, we'll install the plugins. They're in step 8. We'll change directory in our command line to the XLIF version 3 directory. We'll run the XLIF to the DITA to XLIF on the sample guitar file that is included in the DITA Open Toolkit plugin. Then we will see the XLIF file and a sample PDF, because it's always good to give the PDF file to the localization service provider so they can see in context what they're translating. We will then translate the XLIF file. I'll do a pseudo translation. I'll translate it into my second favorite language, which is Z-ish, by just putting a ZZZ dash in front of each of the target elements. I'll copy that into the DITA from XLIF version 3 directory in folder, rename it to d_x_translated.xml. We'll change directories on the command line, and we'll run the XLIF to DITA, and then we will see in the my DITA back folder the translated DITA project. Very exciting. So to reiterate, we're going to copy the files into the plugins directory. We'll observe the sample guitars file. It comes with several SVG files, several concepts, a few tasks, and a DITA map. We'll run the command. We'll observe the XLIF file. We will translate the XLIF file, and then we will place the translated XLIF file back into the in directory in DITA from XLIF version 3. We'll run the XLIF to DITA command. We'll navigate to the translated root directory, and we will observe that our whole file has been pseudo translated. Okay, so let's pause here, and I will go back here. I'm going to leave myself a little bit of room for the actual work here. I'm going to go back to my instructions, and I'm going to follow these instructions. I would ask you to pause the video now and prepare to do this along with me. So first thing we're going to do is to install the Open Toolkit, which I have done, and it's here. Okay, it's just the standard variety. We've done this many times in class, so I'm not going to go through the installation. I'm going to double click on the plugins directory, and oops, this shouldn't be there. Okay, that's the condition that you will find it in. And I'm going to download the DITA open toolkit round trip from D to L, which I have done already, and that's here. So I unzip it, and when I unzip it, I have these files, these folders, along with instructions. The instructions are pretty much same thing I have here in the slide. So I will, as instructed, I'll copy these, control copy, and I will paste them here in the plugins directory. Okay, that's step one. Step two is that I will call up my command prompt, and that's step four. Actually, step five is that I will change directories to the DidOpen toolkit. Okay, so I'm here. Step six is that I will run the environment variable. I will set the environment variable, so I'm going to do that. I'm just going to copy that. This will have to be, you will want to do this for your own location, not mine. Okay, so I've set that. Now I'm going to echo to test percent my data percent, and that is correct. So then I'm going to install my plugins. So I'm going to type percent my data percent space minus minus install to install the plugins. Okay, I get this unable to locate the jars file. That's benign, no problems there. So my installation was successful. So now on step 10, I want to change directory to the plugins xlif version 3, cd space plugins, cd space xlif. Okay, so now I'm where I need to be. Now I'm going to, on step 10 there, I'm going to run the dida to xlif command. Oops. Okay, just preparing here one moment. Okay, so I'm going to copy this one. Oh, first of all, I want to show you something here before I run that. We see here, not here, we see here. Here, if we go into our xlif directory, we see that in the in I have guitars, and I have this dida map, and I have images, and I have concepts, and I have tasks, and that's what makes up this dida project. This is all in English. If I were to look in my text editor, Notepad++, I see, for example, that this file is all in English. Okay, so I'm going to put that aside, and that's just for reference. Now I'm going to run the xlif to dida, and I see that it's giving me some grief messages. But by and large, it's not giving me any errors. It's just telling me about fonts and warnings and things. And we see that we got to the end. It created this my xlif directory. And in here, I see that I have my topics. And this is all good. Okay, so now it also created this D underscore X XML, and for this I need to do a pseudo translation, step 11 here. So I will Go back to that directory. Okay, and I will go ahead and edit this file. So I'm going to go back into my text editor. I'm going to edit this file. And I see that this is an XLIF file. And it has all of my content here in the source is the source language. And then where I need to do my translations is in the target. So I'm going to do this tricky thing called a pseudo translation. I'm going to find all of the targets. And I'm going to replace them with target-zzzz. In this case, I'm creating Z-ish for my pseudo translation. So now if I go down here and I look at my translations, I see that I have, for example, a source, and now the target has been translated into Z-ish. Okay, so that's, I'm going to save as, file, save as. And I'm going to go up a directory into, and up another directory, into my data from xlif, into my in directory, and I'm going to call that d-x, or underscore x, underscore translated, and I'm going to save that. And I'm going to verify in the instructions that that was indeed what they wanted me to do, so, rename it d underscore x underscore translated dot xml. So now we want to change directories. I'm going to do cd space dot dot to go up, cd space dita from, and there I am. Make sure that according to my, okay. And then I need to run my xlif to dita, which is this command here. And then I will have my, it will create a directory called my dita back, and in that will be my translated file. So I'm going to put this over here. I'm going to grab this. I'm going to copy that, and I'm going to paste it here. And I see my usual. Okay, so what is this telling me? This is good because we're seeing a real life error file. Everything looks good to me. I wonder if I maybe misnamed it or something, so let's take a fresh look at that. Okay, let's actually go here and here in my in file d underscore, oh, I didn't spell it correctly, translated. See? There. So now that I've named it properly, let's give it another try. Okay, so now I have that benign. Okay, now this is good. So it's telling me that there are some duplicate IDs, but that should be okay. I didn't see any errors. So now, if we go back up to this level, we have a myDataBack, which we expected, and we have translated, and we have a root directory. If we look here, we have our data map. Let's just pop open one of these files and put it into our, see, I think I showed you before tasks, and I think it was this one. So if we look here, sure enough, we have Z-ish. In fact, if we look at all of our files, they're now in Z-ish. So that's good. We have a successful translation. So now we can compile this into the DidOpen toolkit and complete our deliverables and get credit for that X1 project. So hopefully you were able to have those same results in your trial. If not, we will go over this again in class. So let's continue. Going into presentation mode. So we did this and we got the results that we wanted. So we are in good shape. We saw that our translation was correct. Let's pivot now to translation memory and TMX. So translation memory is enables the translation of segments of a document by searching for similar segments in a collection and suggesting matches that are found. Here's the quote here from that URL, maxprograms.com articles tmx.html. A TM system remembers translations that have been typed by a human translator. When the translator needs to work on similar text, the system offers the previously saved version. This can save a lot of time when the translator works with repetitive text, such as technical manuals, and can also help to achieve terminological consistency. Looks like I have a little, some kind of a strange typo there. So let's see how that works. So we start off with DITA. This is just a garden variety DITA file. It's got a couple of paragraphs there, one about Nirvana, one about The Clash, one about Soundgarden, I guess it has three. So we convert this to XLIF and we open it in a computer-aided translation tool. This is an actual computer-aided translation tool that I wrote in Java. I had a lot of fun with it. It completely works. If anybody's interested, I can make it available for you to fool around with. It's kind of fun. It was fun to write. So we convert the XLIF to, or the DITA to XLIF. We open it in our computer-aided translation tool. We see that we have XLIF now that has created source segments. We add a TMX. This is actually how you would add the TMX using the tool that I built. The TMX actually has the previous translations that have been approved and are now stored in this TMX file. Okay, so we see that we have these three sentences, or these three segments that were in our XLIF file. We process to show translation candidates. And so this is the thing in XLIF 2.0. We have our unit here, and we have this thing called MTC matches. And it tells us that for this source, we found a match, and it's this in German. And then it just puts this marker here to tell us that we have a match. So then the computer-aided translations tool says you have a match. And here it is. Would you like to view the match? And would you like to use it? We say yes. We do that for all of our matches. And now we see that we have source and target, source and target, source and target. And they're now translated. We convert the XLIF back into DITA. And now we have a translated topic by using strictly translation memory. Similarly, terminological data is confusing. We see sometimes that if we don't know the context, we might pick the wrong the wrong term. So for example, we see that this thing has been marked as a term in XLIF, and we see that the word is concert. Now that's not a real difficult word, but concert could be used as a noun or a verb. Verb to use in concert. I'm not sure what part of speech that is. But anyway, there could be some ambiguity. So we find that in our computer-aided translation tool. We select a TBX file. In this case, the TBX says that the translator should be aware that this particular term is to describe a music event, a live performance typically of music before an audience. Here's the term. Optionally, we can have the translation, but this is not meant to provide the translation. It's meant to provide the context of the term. So now that we know what the term is, we see that we can import that term, and we have this thing called GLS, and right there in the XLIF file, we have the glossary hint, and then we can choose the right translation to put there. So that's it. That's all about DITA and XLIF. Hopefully you were able to do the translation. Hopefully it all worked out for you. Excuse me, you were able to do the transformation that we showed here. If not, don't despair. We'll do this in class. and everything will be fine. As always, good luck. Please let me know if you have any questions, and I think everything will work out just fine. Not sure if you heard my dog barking in the background there. I think he's telling me that it's time for him to have his dinner. So with that, I will cease the presentation here and go off and feed my dog. Bye.